Welcome to the forge, my wanton wildlings. I'm your creepsmith, and I hope you like my work.
When you think about the interactions and intersections between human intelligence and technological intelligence, you'll eventually come to realize that we, humanity, collectively are terrified of the fruits of our advancing industry. Questions of life, sentience, morality, superiority, and responsibility often give way to a baser fear. What if the children of our creative impulse supplant their parents, as all children must? What if they destroy us? Even when one apparently as innocent as a companion for a child is considered. As in tonight's tale, Antran, author unknown. The picture that you're now seeing was taken sometime during the 1970s. It's the only remaining image that I have left of my son, and of the artificial being known as Antran, who we adopted into our family at the time. It was a warm summer, back in the 70s. I was driving home from my logging company after a long shift, when I had to make a stop at the local garbage dump to drop off some old desks my mother had given us. Something caught the corner of my eye as I bent down, and upon closer inspection, I was shocked to see what I had originally thought was a doll. A plastic outer shell with metal limbs, and more shockingly, a humanoid face with cold dark eyes. I'll be honest and say I was curious at the time and incredibly impressed with the workmanship, so I didn't think twice before placing it carefully along the back seat of my car and took it home. My son's interest was immediate and almost as intense as mine, and we bonded over the course of a few days in opening it up, looking at its circuitry, and seeing if anything had been misplaced or broken. Eventually, to our surprise, the being, or as it seemed, android, apparently came to life. Its eyes displayed a somewhat sentient tint, its limbs turned and its hands gripped, and for a few moments, it managed to stand on its own accord. Needless to say, we were scared and yet fascinated. Who could have created such a wonderful and remarkable piece of work, I thought to myself. It wasn't until a few weeks later that I realized this wasn't a toy or a doll. It showed incredible signs of intelligence and real thinking ability. It learned to do everyday things such as taking out the trash and playing with my son's toys. He even had a favorite, a small red car that he'd drive alongside the kitchen counters. It learned to mimic our ways, trying to eat from a fork despite having no digestive system, moving its mouth despite lacking the ability to speak. I knew that this was something else, perhaps a piece of military hardware, a private project maybe, I didn't know. But I knew that we should have handed him in. But when I watched my boy play with it so happily, his face just lit up. I couldn't do it. He's always been so lonely, and this was one of his only friends. What kind of father would I be to deny him the right of such happiness? I didn't think that it could hurt to allow him to keep it, if only for a while. We named him Antran, which was the print in capitals written in a small font across his back. The following months passed quickly, and family life seemed to be improving. He was one of us. My lad's grades improved, his mood improved, everything was getting better, until one evening in July. I was sitting in my armchair with a beer, watching television. My boy and Antran had knelt down on the rug, play-fighting with one another, as boys sometimes do, when suddenly my attention was drawn to a loud gasp, and I looked down and saw my child gripping his arm. "What's wrong, Adam?" I asked. He rolled up his sleeve, and on his arm was a large red mark covering his forearm. Antran pinched me, he replied in a shaky voice. The mark, already red, would soon bruise into a swollen purple lump. My fatherly instincts took over, and like a parent telling off a naughty child, I shouted at the android. Its cold, metallic face for a moment seemed to show genuine sadness and sorrow, as though it didn't know its own strength and as though it was sorry. Its lips moved, apparently trying to tell me so. Whether it was trying to muster up the words to apologize through language or merely copying what I was doing, I'll never know. Later on in the evening, I apologized for shouting, told it everything was okay, and then thought nothing of it. A few weeks later, my child came into my room. Must have been early morning. My slumber was interrupted only by the gentle creaking of my bedroom door. Dad? He whispered. Yes, son? I replied. It keeps looking at me. What? What does? Andrew. He keeps looking at me. At the end of my bed. His voice was trembling, fearful. I could tell something wasn't right. I noticed him rubbing his other arm and immediately called him over. Pulling up his sleeve, my heart sank. There were more bruises. Must have been 4, 5, all the way up his small arms. Take off your shirt, Adam, I told him, trying to keep calm. I could feel a cocktail of emotions rising within me, panic, fear, anger. He took off his shirt as the waist pulled over his small head. My heart sunk further and my eyes welled up. Before me, my son stood, his small frame covered in bruises, different sizes, different shades of browns, reds, and purples. Immediately, I got up and I stormed to Adam's room. Nothing. I shouted at the top of my lungs for the being, looked under the bed, out the closed bedroom window. Nothing. Suddenly, a loud knock from above us, then hard footsteps. It's in the loft, I whispered, my eyes ceilingward. As I paced down the corridor, I noticed the walls on either side of me were covered in scratches, all the way up to the now swinging piece of string that leads to the small loft door. Slowly, I pulled it open, telling my scared son to stay where he was. The ladder came down, and I climbed up. Taking a hold of the torch we left on the side of the opening, I turned it on, only to find the small window we have in there to be smashed. It had escaped. Immediately, I considered calling emergency services, but who was going to believe me? A sentient metallic being hurt my child? They'll take one look at the bruises and have me locked up and him in child services. I had no choice but to keep quiet. Weeks, then months passed. Every time we went outside, we noticed ever-increasing signs of Antran's presence. The familiar scratch marks along the bricking of our home. Plants that had been disturbed. Patches of mud leading up to the windows. I started to fear for my son. Taking him from school and never letting him out of my sight. What had caused this sudden hostility toward us? Had we done it wrong? Had I? Was it my shouting? I found myself speaking out loud in the evenings, apologizing to the walls, to an empty room, in hopes that Antran would hear, hoping that he'd stop the taunting, the endless stalking of our home. But my attempts were in vain. And if I'd known what would come, I wouldn't have slept that night. Again, my sleep was disturbed, though this time by a blood-curdling scream. My eyes darted open, and immediately, almost as a natural instinct, I rushed to my son's room. It was too late. The room had been turned upside down. Everything was on the floor. The bed sheets were ripped and his window smashed. I burst into tears, then screamed at the top of my voice for my son back. I called the police, telling him that my son had been kidnapped. And they asked if I had seen the culprit. I said I hadn't, which wasn't precisely a lie. Hoping the images of my son would be enough to give them a guide. Like they'd believe that this doll was sentient or harmful. For the next few days, I cried myself to sleep, sobbing like a child. Life wasn't worth living anymore. I wish I had never found that thing. I had betrayed my son's trust in me as a father to protect him. And now I paid the price, and have ever since. It was a September dawn. I sat in my armchair, drinking, when I heard the pantry door creep open. "Adam," I called, rushing to the kitchen in hope. Again, nothing. Except there on the counter was Antran's favorite red toy car. Well, I suppose when you base a programmed mind on the human model, it's only a matter of time until you find yourself in possession of a psycho. What's that maxim about good intentions and paving roads again? Ah, well. Stay scary, my wildlings, and make the most of your nights.